What do 9 Gen X and Boomer judges in DC have to do with our lived experience? Almost everything. I'll explain. As if 2020 couldn't get any worse, beloved liberal icon Ruth Bader Ginsburg passed away at age 87. You don't need me to tell you that the stakes in this election are high, but I am here to remind you that this one single vote for president is about so much more than Joe Biden or Donald Trump. The truth is, whoever wins the presidency will fill around 4,000 powerful government jobs, including lifetime appointments to the Supreme Court and the federal bench. The cases they decide will have immediate consequences for us, our children, and probably even our grandchildren. Seriously, SCOTUS is so important because it has the final say in major issues like healthcare, LGBTQ+ rights, and access to abortion. In many ways, justices are even more influential than the president because once confirmed by the Senate, they get a lifelong tenure. They're essentially unfireable, and this untouchable status is supposed to shield them from political influence, but over the last few years, Supreme Court nominations have been at the center of messy partisan scandals. Like the time Senate Republicans refused to even schedule a confirmation hearing on Obama nominee Merrick Garland. Their reason, you ask?
It's campaign season. We're right in the middle of it. And one of the most important issues now is this. Who will Americans trust to nominate the next Supreme Court justice?
The Senate left the seat open for 237 days, and we all know what happened next. Just days after taking office, President Trump nominated conservative Neil Gorsuch, soon followed by a speedy confirmation of controversial Justice Brett Kavanaugh. Some Republicans assured Democrats that if the shoe were on the other foot, the same thing would happen.
If there's a Republican president in 2016 and a vacancy occurs in the last year of the first term, you can say, Lindsey Graham said, let's let the next president, whoever it might be, make that nomination.
But just 5 weeks before the 2020 election, that same senator had this to say about filling RBG's seat.
We've got the votes to confirm the judge, the justice on the floor of the Senate before the election, and that's what's coming.
This all seems pretty cynical and unfair, doesn't it? You might be thinking the fight for the Supreme Court is over once the Senate confirms Trump's third nominee. But here's why that's dangerous thinking. Justices don't always and shouldn't vote down party lines. The deciding vote on Obamacare's constitutionality was by Chief Justice John Roberts, who was appointed by Republican George W. Bush. There is at least one thing we can do to rebalance the court, and that's by expanding it to more than 9 justices. The Constitution doesn't list a specific number of judges, and the amount has changed multiple times before, but in order for this to happen, Democrats would need to control the presidency and Congress. If you're still not convinced you should be concerned, take it from Samia Ali. She's a former SCOTUS clerk. What, in your opinion, are the most important qualities that a president should look for in nominating a Supreme Court justice?
The court needs to reflect the people whose lives are in its hand. It needs to support the country. You know, we need diversity among the lines we always think about. So like racial diversity, gender, sexual orientation, religion, ability status, language. But we also need diversity in the legal experience. The current administration has been nominating judges throughout the federal judiciary from the lower to the top that are very young. People that are nominated at 30 or 40 could be on the bench for another 40 years. And so these are just like monumental decisions that we need to be looking at and monitoring very closely.
Right. And with the federal judges, which are also appointed by the president, can you speak about their influence a little bit? Like, how does that affect our lives?
I almost think that the lower federal courts have a bigger influence than the Supreme Court.
How so?
The Supreme Court only hears, you know, between 60 and 80 cases every year, but all of the cases go through the lower federal courts. If you are trying to challenge some restriction on climate laws, you're starting in the district court. And so those judges make the very first decisions about these issues.
Should we be concerned right now? Like, now that we know like the full scope of the influence of the federal and Supreme Court, and the fact that the current president has appointed a lot of conservative judges to these positions, should young people who are progressive be concerned?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, absolutely. In the next 4 years, a president could fill nearly half the judiciary through their nominations at the rate that they're going right now. They'll be deciding everything from, you know, whether people can discriminate against you based on something that you can't change, to whether Facebook can send you spam messages, you know? So it is imperative that we take control of that.
In the past few years, Trump has appointed around 200 federal judges, which is more than any other president in recent history. His judges make up about a quarter of those currently on the bench. Two-thirds are white men, way less diverse, and often less qualified than past appointees. Some received literal not qualified ratings from the American Bar Association. This conservative flooding of the courts harms the ideological balance and interests of younger generations, especially since so many of us are more socially liberal. So, if you're just not that motivated by the presidential candidates on this year's ballot, consider how much Supreme Court and federal judges could seriously affect our daily lives and the future of our country.